Prosperous American middle-class world of the early 1950s revolved around work, family, and good clean entertainment. On the new medium of television, stars would sing from an ordered songbook of ballads with a formal phrasing and Broadway presentation that had changed little in 30 years.
And stars fell on Alabama last night.
Seemed like a world that would go on forever. Some of the first stirrings of change came from the banks of the Mississippi.
Fats Domino, he was at the Hideaway Club that was downtown New Orleans, Louisiana. We walked into the place. Lou Judd was with me, the guy who owned Imperial Record Company at the time. The whole place was rocking. And I say, this guy has got it.
Dave Bartholomew took Fats Domino's classic New Orleans sound of piano and sax and rearranged it to offer white kids an easy first step into the world of black music.
We actually sweetened his background some. And when we sweetened that, and we found out that we would do what is more or less called crossover in this business. Rhythm and blues would only sell at that time maybe 100,000 records. But we found out the guys who were buying pop, they were selling like a million. So we crossed over and we went to Ain't That a Shame, and we never looked back.
You make me cry when you think goodbye. Ain't that a shame?
Previously, black artists had always been kept on special rhythm and blues charts, and their records only released by small independent labels. Fats was one of the first to cross over.
Just flowed along, and you know, it wasn't a complicated thing at all.
And his material was something that you hear it once and you could sing it right away. Not maybe remember the lyrics, but you hummed the melody, would just stuck right with you because it was so simple.
That's what get the people, and what they start doing is digging down in their pocket to pay for that record. Thank you.
Fats Domino's early success was partly because he was completely non-threatening, which could never be said of a young singer who was about to rattle New Orleans with the force of a hurricane off the Gulf of Mexico.
Good golly, Miss Molly! Sure like the bone! Woo! Golly, Miss Molly! Sure like the bone!
When I first met old Richard, it was incredible. I was in Augusta, Georgia, and Richard came over with all this makeup and this loud suit. I can't remember what the color it was. It was a young man, you know. I was standing by my car, and he said, I want a car just like that. I want to get me a car just like that. I want to get out of Georgia, blah, blah, blah.
Georgia was always too subdued for the young Richard Payne. Born in 1932, he grew up with 11 brothers and sisters in a poor black neighborhood by the railroad tracks.
The train would shake the house that was in front of the track. Everybody would get out of the bed because the train shook the house because they couldn't sleep. And the train would say, chucka, 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 chucka. And it was, to me, it was a rhythm. To me, it was just like a song, you know, and it had this thing to it, to me.
Little Richard, as he decided to call himself, was to take Fats Domino's sound even further with a unique vocal style that came from listening to the elders in his childhood church.
There wasn't no piano and no organ or nothing. You know, they were stump their feet. Everybody just stump their feet. You know, everybody be rocking. Everybody, no music, everybody. I'm a bossy, and merely to save myself. You know, everybody, you know, that was that old thing. Now, wasn't no piano beating, and wasn't no organ playing. It was just people's old folks stomping their feet and moaning and groaning. Lucy, baby, satisfy my heart. Lucy, baby, satisfy my heart. I play by with you, baby, the days are such a wonderful star.
When Little Richard first came to New Orleans in the early 50s, the city was a rich gumbo of people of all races, united by a love for good times and rhythmic music.
Baby, don't you need a man?
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I'm glad to be here, and I hope you are the same. So, Miss Thoreau, you are now finna hear Little Richard and his upsetters.
He first began to make a name for himself and develop his outrageous stage act in clubs like the Dewdrop Inn, where his act was staged between exotic dancers and female impersonators. Then, in 1955, he came to record at a studio on the edge of the French Quarter, just as Fats Domino had done, using many of the same musicians.
Little Richard was a total extrovert, and he really worked real hard at doing his very best. He's gay, and I guess it was part of a kind of Queen of the May complex, but he really wanted to be the very best. And if you talk to him, and even till today, he'll tell you he's the best.
I'm the innovator, I'm the emancipator, I'm the originator, I'm the architect of rock and roll. Don't you forget it, this is me. Nobody but me, ain't nothing like me nowhere.
Wow.
Wow.
Exactly.
You have to realize that he came in with this high pompadour on his head with a collar that was made like an oriental. Yeah, it was staying up in the back, and I saw him, I said, the dragon lady from this. From the cartoon, you know, that I saw in the movie.
Terry the Pirates.
Richard was really...
He was outside.
Yeah.
Woo! We had finished the session in the studio, and they wanted me to sound like Ray Charles and B.B. King, but I was tired of that. You know, being young and a teenager, I wanted to sound different. Me and the young kids, we was tired of all that slow music. We wanted the boogie. You know, same as when rap music came in today, the kids got tired of what's going on. They wanted something different. They wanted something from their generation. You know, so what I did, I started singing Tutti Frutti loud as I can. Wop, bop, loom, bop, lop, bam, boom, woo, just screaming. And people say, oh, he's going crazy.
Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh, Rudy. Tutti Frutti, oh,
Little Richard was so hot. If you went into town behind Richard, say in Annapolis, Indiana, you had to wait 2 months if he was there, 3 months, because he would sweep the whole town clean. Everybody went to see Little Richard. He was so excited.
But the white station wouldn't play black records. You had to, it was about four or five black radio stations in the whole country. And the white station wouldn't play me. But I was hitting big. But the white kids had my record, but I wasn't on the radio, you know, and they would hear from WLAC, called WLAC, and across the whole country.
It was radio that began to break down the musical barriers. Driving up from New Orleans to Memphis, the listener could hear a wide variety of radio stations, all with segregated playlists of country or ballads. Then a few disc jockeys at all-white WLAC Nashville began playing rhythm and blues for black listeners.
All right, WLAC Blues Time.
The old jiving horse man, Bill Allen. We got music for you tonight.
Wynonna Harris.
I got some good rocking tonight.
They found that white kids started to tune in too, drawn by the mystery of these late night sounds.
It was a phenomenon. It was something that was happening. It was completely new. Now, it had been black music forever, and all of these songs had been around. Blues had been around forever, but they'd been in the black community and nowhere else.
All right, friends, coming up right now, Louis Jordan, the Timpani Five, and Saturday Night Fish Fry. Let it rip.
If you ever been down to New Orleans, then you can understand just what I mean. Now, all through the week, it's quiet as a mouse, but on Saturday night, they go from house to house. You don't have to pay the usual admission if you're a cook or a waiter or a good musician. So if you happen to be just passing by, stop in at Saturday Night Fish Fry.
I play a record, and I said, man, I did tight like it. And it would just come out, you know, something would come out. And then people would call and they'd say, are you black or white? Or are you black or white? Oh, man, are you black? And I said, does it make any difference? And I never said one way or the other.
And people knew about black music all over the country because it was a 50,000 clear watt station. And he went way down. Way up, way over, way across, you can hear Horse Allen.
Down in New Orleans where everything is fine, all them cats is
white disc jockeys elsewhere caught the trend. In Cleveland, Alan Freed began playing rhythm and blues and called it rock and roll, black slang for sex. As did fast-talking, hard-drinking DJ Dewey Phillips in a city that became another crossroads for the new music. Memphis. Memphis, black energy and white energy started to come together in a way that would eventually cause rock and roll to explode across the whole country. The catalyst for this transracial fusion was a 27-year-old radio engineer who decided to record some of the songs he was hearing.
All of our equipment was relatively inexpensive, but believe me, we had to know what to do with it or we would have had nothing. And all of the young people, this is the thing I'm proudest of, I guess, that we had here in this studio, black and white. Believe me, take my word for it, unequivocally, the thing I'm proudest of, all of us were just, we were just beginners. you know, just beginners.
My baby woke up this morning, says, B, you must clean out and go.
Phillips had first opened his Memphis recording service in 1950 when he began to record black bluesmen from around the Mid-South. A 26-year-old B.B. King cut his first record there and recommended Phillips' studio to a new band led by his childhood friend, Ike Turner.
B.B., he's a man, good as you guys are, he's a man. Let me set up an appointment with you, for you, at the record company that I'm with. And we said, yeah, really? So we didn't have no songs, man, because Rocket 88 was wrote on the way to Memphis. We didn't have nothing original at all, nothing. So he said, this is like on a Sunday, and so he said he was going to set it up with the guy in Memphis, which he was referring to was Sam Phillips.
If I could get them in there and have them be themselves and turn off the idea that they're playing music for any white man sitting behind the glass, we might have some fun.
You've heard of jalopies, you've heard the noise they make, but let me introduce my new Rocket 88. Yes,
when I recorded Rocket 88, it really did get a lot of attention, because now it broadened almost immediately the base of which young white males and females began to get even more interested in rhythm and blues or black music.
The white bubblegum kids in those days started listening to Rocket 88, you know, I think it's mostly, you know, whites like actually a lot of boogie-woogie, a lot of boogie-woogie with the twanging singing on top of it. It's actually nothing but boogie. That's what it really is.
The success of Rocket 88 inspired Phillips to start his own label, Sun Records. Over the next few years, he recorded a score of local black artists and developed an influential recording style, using unamplified instruments and a slight tape delay to give an echoey, raw feel to the music.
I hate to say this, but I did get a lot of criticism for recording black people. I mean, a lot of it was a friendly type of thing. But you know, I didn't give one holy damn.
Now, when I was a little boy, at the age of 5.
Many of the black artists Phillips had recorded went north to Chicago in search of bigger audiences.
Now I'm a man, May 21.
The south side of the city was home to another independent label, founded in 1950 by brothers Phil and Leonard Chess. Leonard Chess died in 1969, leaving his son Marshall and brother Phil.
I always felt that my family were immigrants. They came from Poland. And the blacks that came to Chicago from the South were immigrants. They both came to the big city to do what? To make some money, to get a better, make a better life for themselves. So, you know, my family and the blacks they worked with, it was a great marriage, you know, because for both of them, it was a way to better their lives.
And a sweet little home.
The Chesses recorded what came to be known as Chicago blues. Mississippi Delta bluesmen like Howlin' Wolf and the great Muddy Waters, who now used electric guitars and amplified harmonicas to be heard over the din in big city nightclubs. The electrification was to prove crucial for rock and roll.
We noticed that the electric sound, the echo, all those kind of gimmicks really were catching on, something new. So Chess, then we started looking for new and different things. You know, that's what, you know, we saw that the original and the fresh stuff, the fresh sound, was what sold records.
By the mid-50s, just when Little Richard and Sam Phillips were beginning to have hits elsewhere, The Chesses were operating out of a storefront studio in a neighborhood of Chicago known as Little Mississippi, where most black families lived and worked.
There was a bus stop right in front. And in the summertime, we'd have our door open. We had the turntable, and we'd cut a session the night before, and we'd put the test record of the dub.
Play it over and over.
Over, and you see these old women standing with a Muddy Waters record.
You're waiting for the bus.
I say, what is that? Man, that sure sound good. Well, uh-oh, we got a record.
So little goodbye, baby, diamond ring.
In March 1955, the Chesses heard a different sound. Electric guitar played in a new way by an eccentric black man who called himself Bo Diddley. His family had moved up to Chicago from Mississippi, and until he acquired his first guitar, the young Bo Diddley had studied violin at the Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church.
Sister Lucille bought me a guitar for Christmas, and Mama Gussie wasn't too happy about it, but I got it. You know, and like all parents, you ain't gonna play that in here, boy. I didn't see anything wrong with it, so I taught myself. I was just kind of a weird fellow with music. I wanted to do my thing. I didn't want to do something I heard somebody else do. Mainly playing chords and stuff like that in rhythm. I'm a rhythm fanatic. I play the guitar as if I were playing drums. That's the thing that makes my music so different. I do licks on the guitar that the drummer would do.
Bo Diddley was an original guy. He had women in his band.
He had the Duchess,
then he had Cookie.
Yeah.
He had different instruments. He had electric violin in his band. He had maracas in his band. He wasn't afraid to experiment.
Primetime television was gradually beginning to acknowledge the growing popularity of black music, although they could still present Bo Diddley as being more of a novelty act than anything more threatening. But Bo Diddley's rhythms would become rock and roll mainstays and help to establish the literally electrifying effect the guitar would have on the new music. With a guitar beside him in his Ford pickup, another young musician drove up to Chicago in 1955 from his home in the South.
Deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, way back up in the woods among the evergreens, there stood a log cabin made of earth and wood, where lived a country boy named Johnny B. Good, who never ever learned to read or write so well, but he could play a guitar just like a ringing a bell. Go, go!
All right, friends, blues coming to you out of the night from WLAC in Nashville. Here's a big one, honey. Chuck Berry and Maybelline.
Maybelline, why can't you be true?
Chuck Berry walked into our studio at 4750 South Cottage, and he walked in with a little tape, demo tape. And he had, we listened to the sides, and it was different.
Again, different.
Different.
Tunes like We Ours were the backbone of the band led by pianist Johnny Johnson, with whom Chuck Berry first played and sang.
When I hired him in my group, we were playing just standard blues and whatever, and Chuck he wasn't interested in that too much, because he had his own style that he was interested in, which was country and western or hillbilly, whatever you want to call it. It had a different feel to it and everything, which went similar to this.
Style was different. The backbeat was different. It was the birth of the beat.
In fact, the beat wasn't heavy enough. My brother went out in the studio and got a phone book and took a drum stick and was banging it. He wasn't even keeping time, but he was just banging it just to get the beat heavier.
Maybelline, why can't you be true?
Working for my father in the white neighborhoods, I never heard Muddy Waters. I never heard Elmore James. I heard Frank Sinatra. I heard Pat Boone, you know. Pat Boone doing Muddy Waters or whoever's number, you know, selection. But then I said, now why can't I do as Pat Boone does and play good music for the white people and sell as well there as I could in the neighborhood?
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline.
In the summer of 1955, Maybelline reached number 5 on the main pop charts, the first top 10 hit for Chess Records.
Remember, he took it to Alan Freed.
Yeah,
in the car, I remember that.
Yeah.
He drove it to New York to Alan Freed. And then again, Alan Freed was
Alan
exposing
Freed.
Black music to white kids.
Alan Freed, Joe Finan, Mickey Shore. At that time, it was just starting to break. You could see what, by the trend of what they were playing, that the white kids were starting to go for the stuff. At that time, I think he was one of the greatest for that kind of music, you know, for young, appealing to young kids. He really had it.
He had great intuition as to what young white teenagers, their lives. I mean, he wrote about their experiences and what was going through their mind.
Up in the morning and out to school, the teacher is teaching the golden rule, American history and practical math.
I wrote about school, and half of the people have cars. I wrote about cars, and mostly all of the people, if they're not now, they'll soon be in love, and those that have love and are out of love, remember love, so write about love. So I wrote about all three, and I thought it hit pretty good capacities of people.
Sweet little 16, you just got to have about a half a million signed autographs. Her wallet filled with pictures, she gets them one by one. I'm so excited, I watch her look at her run. Oh,
there's a lot of places we played when they would call Chuck Berry out. There would be a lot of, you know, like, this ain't supposed to be a black man, it's supposed to be a white man singing this kind of song, you know. And while he was getting himself together, and you could hear through the crowd, I thought he was white. And then he would strike out in his song, you know. So it was really a novelty on that deal.
Here you had blacks coming up from the South, really from, you know, connected to slavery, coming up from the Deep South to Chicago, getting jobs in Chicago and Detroit in factories, making money for the first time, buying cars. Then you had this whole young white population of teenagers who were coming out of really a lot of repression from the early 50s. And all of a sudden, the beat and lyrics joined up, and they sort of joined together, the black energy and the white and the young white teen energy, to cause the birth of rock and roll. They rode each other right out.
You can't give Chuck Berry to a black. We care less about Chuck Berry. Now we can, blacks can accept Jimmy Reed. You got me run. You got me hiding. We can accept that. But man, we're just way down in Louisiana, close to damn Louisiana.
We've set up a 20-man committee to do away with this vulgar, animalistic, nigger rock and roll box.
The obscenity and vulgarity of the rock and roll music is obviously a means by which the white man and his children can be driven to the level with the nigger. It is obviously nigger music.
They accused us of causing white people to love niggers. They accused us of mutilating music by trying to integrate and try to copy and just totally destroy all that was good in music. And so, believe me, the resistance on this was absolutely incredible.
The backlash didn't come from the population in America. It came mostly from the South and a few people who didn't want to see this music. Because again, now here's what you're doing. Remember, when I say white people, white girls like that music. They was coming around seeing them little black boys and shaking and stuff like that. That was a no-no in this country.
They would say, that boy gonna come to town singing that black music and gonna run our children crazy. You understand me? Because this black music was so intense. It was so full of power and rhythm. It was so full of that fervency. It had it going on.
White America and some black America wasn't ready for it. You know, they didn't understand it. Hey, what is this, you know?
And then they took Pat Boone and threw Pat Boone on me.
Oh, bop, 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 bop,
It wasn't something that was done in the beginning when it was rhythm and blues, because it was supposed to be not nice music at all. So you didn't have white artists doing black music. It wasn't acceptable. But when it crossed over to the white audience and it was a song that did well with blacks and some whites, they said, well, hey, this is a good vehicle. We'll make even more money.
And Pat Boone said, a wop babaloom bop a lop bam boom. And I said, I still say, a wop babaloom bop a lop bam boom. And the white kids wanted to hear a wop babaloom bop a lop bam boom. Woo! They wanted to hear me. And so they were still bringing me in their house. And they didn't want their mama to know I was in the house. So they put Pat Boone on top of the bed and they put me in the drawer. But I was still in the same house.
But if Boone was just a pale imitation of the real thing, there were some white performers who would bring their own energies to the music.
I had always thought at that particular time in history, and that's exactly what it is and was, that if I could find a white Southern boy, we just might be able to do at least a few of the things that I knew it would take a long time to do.
Evening shadows make me blue. When each weary day...
That moment came when 18-year-old truck driver Elvis Presley walked into Sun Studios and paid $3.98 to cut a record of himself singing My Happiness.
Every day I reminisce.
I knew when he walked in the door, baby. I said, uh-oh, hey. If anybody can do this, I believe this is the person that can do it.
Sam Phillips knew of a country band called the Starlight Wranglers, and he decided to recruit one of their guitar players to work up some songs with Presley, Scotty Moore.
After he left, I called Sam, told him, I said, boy's got, you know, decent voice, knows a lot of songs, just a matter of, you know, what you might be able to put together.
I love you because you understand.
Phillips brought them together with bass player Bill Black to record the ballads they had worked up. But the feeling Sam had hoped for wasn't coming through.
This day we had wound up and the session and about ready to bag up the instruments and go home. So I went in and talked to him and said, hey, we still are not where I believe we should be, and I think we all agree on this. And so I turned around, went back in the control room, and the next thing I know, Elvis still had his guitar, his flat top around his neck with a strap on his shoulder. And he cut out on That's All Right, Mama.
Sam came out and said, what are y'all doing? And we said, just goofing around, you know. He said, well, that beat sounds pretty good. So get on mic, let's run through a couple more times.
There was just a certain rhythm that he started out with. And man, the minute I heard that thing, I said, Lord. Yeah, I mean, if we can just attach a few little appendages to this thing, it's gonna make some noise that satisfies the soul.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do it, that's all right. That's all right.
Presley's feel for the blues and country music was deeply rooted in his childhood. His parents had always struggled to make ends meet, living in subsidized housing, cheek by jowl with poor whites and poor blacks.
Son, that gal you foolin' wish she ain't all good for you, but that's all right.
The young Elvis heard the blues on Memphis front porches and on WLAC from people like Arthur Big Boy Crudup, who'd recorded the original That's All Right, Mama.
It was just tough times back in those days, you know, and I guess the kids, that's all they had to do. I mean, you either get out and have street fights or get your guitar and start playing. So I didn't want to get in trouble, so I got a guitar and started picking guitar. And all my friends, most of my friends did. Because I guess we all came out the same mold, seemed like. All everybody I knew, Johnny Dorsey Burnett, Elvis, Bill Black, Scotty Moore, they all came out of the same type environment.
That's all right.
As a young man, Presley was attracted to many aspects of black culture around Memphis, shopping at Lansky Brothers on Beale Street for flashy clothes, and slipping into black juke joints.
He was driving a gravel truck, and he used to come around through the alley to the back of this place, and my piano, not this time, it was the old upright piano, was sitting right by the door, and I had it pulled out from the wall to where I could kind of face the audience, because if it fell against the wall, I'd be looking straight across. So I wanted to see the audience, so I had to pull out. Well, the distance that I would pull it from the wall was where he would be behind the piano, and when he would watch me play. That's where he, when you see him stand up, he'd be doing his legs, when he'd be playing with the guitar. All this came from back in those days when we used to do it, you know.
Now, when we worked different people like Elvis Presley, I always worked him right here in this very spot. He would stand here, and this way he would have Scotty there, or a little bit to the right of there, and Bill Black right here. He could look around and see me at the control room.
That's all right. That's all right, Mama.
And we turned around, and I said, hey, do you know anything else that's as wild as that? And he cut down on, I mean, you talking about a classic, Blue Moon of Kentucky? Blew me away.
Well, now, before I heard Elvis do Blue Moon of Kentucky, I'd always heard it by Bill Monroe. And, of course, he did it. He wrote it, and he did it completely different. He did it as a waltz, more like a ballad, like, Blue Moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and said goodbye. Blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and said goodbye. Then here comes Elvis, sir, you know. Blue moon, blue moon, blue moon, keep shining bright. Blue moon, keep on shining bright. You're gonna bring me back my baby tonight. Blue moon,
keep shining bright. I say blue moon of Kentucky, they keep on shining. Shine on the one that's gone and left me blue. I say blue moon of Kentucky, they keep on shining.
Hey! old boot is in full Roscoe Gordon. The next 15 minutes of real hot blues coming to you to courtesy of that good old Negro Flower. We're going to play the next record for Leanne Sandwich, for Erna Keane, Annie L. Sandwich, for Canty, for Corporal Monroe Williams. Here's a record that's getting hot, man.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do.
Memphis DJ Dewey Phillips broke That's All Right, Mama and Blue Moon of Kentucky for the first time on his Red Hot and Blue show.
But I heard that song, and I said, gosh, what a sound. You know, I was going to work, and I was driving. I had the radio on. I said, wow, that knocked me out, you know. Then he called it out, Elvis Presley, Scotty Moore, and Bill Black.
That's all right. That's all right.
Across much of the South, Presley's record caused great confusion, and some DJs refused to play it. Presley sounded too black. And was he country or rhythm and blues? He needed to get in front of live audiences so people could see for themselves. So Elvis, Scotty, and Bill went on the road and performed in public for the first time.
He went out and sang a couple songs, then he sang That's All Right, Mama. So then he started in that dee 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 da da dee dee, shaking his leg. And all the girls said, I said, going, ah, just screaming, holding their head, you know, and everything, and hollering.
He stood on the balls of his feet. His heels off, actually off the floor. And then in playing the guitar and singing, well, he'd get to kind of bouncing. Well, when he started bouncing, his britches legs started shaking. And the girls out in the first two, three rows started just screaming and hollering. Nobody knew what they was, really what it was all about. And, but that's what it was. Of course, after we found out, well, he started embellishing and embellishing, and didn't he embellish?
Well, we're going to rock. We're going to rock. In the audience at one of Elvis's shows was a young fan from Lubbock, Texas, called Buddy Holly, who was intrigued by what he saw and came backstage afterwards. Presley's early performances inspired him to start up a band himself.
You're a heartbreaker, you're a love faker, a heartbreaker playing with fire.
Sam Phillips had already started to build up a stable of other white artists around Presley. But you can't break my heart. But it was Elvis, drawing on both his Southern boy roots and love of the blues, who really defined the rockabilly style.
Take your place, someone I can always trust and fill the safe space. You're a heartbreaker, you're a heartbreaker.
Soon real hits started to come for him, and for Carl Perkins, with his fetishistic concern for footwear.
For the month, for the show, get ready now, go cat, go, but don't step on my blue suede shoes. Yeah, you can do it painfully off my blue suede shoes. Well,
by the time Carl Perkins recorded Blue Suede Shoes at the end of 1955, the major companies had finally started to wake up to rock and roll's potential. That December, Sam Phillips accepted RCA's bid of $35,000 for Elvis.
I needed the money so bad. And people have asked me repeatedly, do you regret selling Elvis Presley? I do not. And I did not. And I will not. It gave me the financing when I sold it, his contract to RCA, to merchandise Blue Suede Shoes, which, I mean, you know what it is, don't you? It's an anthem.
Well, it's the one for the money, two for the show, three to get it ready. Now, go, cat, go, don't you step on my blue suede shoes.
Ironically, almost the first thing Presley did for RCA was to record a cover of the same song. Together with Elvis's new manager, Colonel Tom Parker, RCA launched him nationally. By the end of 1956, he would have two number one albums and a dozen appearances on network television.
We didn't like doing television that much. It was just too, you had to stand on this strip of tape and don't turn the volume up too loud. And usually when the show started, well, we'd go ahead and move around and turn the volume up and whatever anyway. Probably the Milton Berle show was the first one that everybody really felt real loose.
As we were doing that Berle show, we used to do the Hound Dog straight ahead, and then we go out. But all of a sudden, he decides he's going to go into this blues thing. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. That was the first time he had done it anywhere, and we all looked at each other, what do we do now? And so we said, we better follow him. So we did, and I went back into my roots of playing strip music, actually. I used to work in burlesque houses when I was a youngster, and I just figured, well, I better catch his blues licks and his legs and arms and do everything I can to get out of this song, because we didn't know how to get out or how to get back in. We were just, it's like every man for himself, actually.
You ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound. You ain't nothing but a hound.
Presley was becoming the biggest attraction on television, but America's most prestigious host, Ed Sullivan, maintained he would never present such vulgar entertainment.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Your Mercury dealer and your Lincoln dealer present the Ed Sullivan Show.
But by autumn 1956, Elvis was just too big for even Sullivan to ignore.
You can come around and lose his telephone. Call me
Over the 10 months Presley had been away from Sam Phillips, his music had become tamer, sweetened with background singers, his delivery more contained. RCA, Colonel Parker, and Presley himself wanted to reach a wider, more mainstream audience. Arguably, he would never again record with the raw vitality of his early Sun sessions. In Memphis, Sam Phillips had discovered another explosive talent ready to be unleashed. Between Memphis and New Orleans in Ferryday, Louisiana, the man they were to call the Killer shared with Little Richard a gospel upbringing. A boogie version of Drinking Wine's Bodie Odie, a tune by black blues singer Stick McGee, was the first song Jerry Lee Lewis performed professionally at the age of 13 for just a few dollars.
Come on, baby, pass that old bottle to me.
Well, I remember my Aunt Minnie Bell Swaggart, Jimmy's mother. She got on me about that song. She said, "Now, Jerry, that's not a Christian song." I said, I don't know. I think it's a good song, Aunt Minnie Bell. She said, "It's not a Christian song." I said, "No, but it's a good boogie-woogie song." And that was 1949.
When he was 15, Lewis's mother sent him to Texas to study for the ministry. But honky-tonk music always pulled at his soul.
There was a young preacher, he said, "Jerry Lee, they want me to do a do My God Is Real in church, would you accompany me on the piano? I said, sure, I'd be glad to. No, I didn't play it like Hearts and Things. I mean, that's the way some people did. Well, I did it. There are some things. Like that, and I showed him how to do it, boogie style, you know, and he actually just tore him up, everybody except the dean. And although I saw that dean, he was doing like this to me.
Lewis's expulsion from the Southwestern Bible Institute tossed him back into Delta dives and honky-tonks. In 1955, he heard about Sam Phillips.
I went up to Memphis, me and my dad, and we sold about 39 dozen eggs, raised some money, get some gas. And we went up there, and I met Jack Clement, and he said Sam was in Florida on vacation.
Jack told me, says, I've got a piano picker that wants you to hear him. He's been hanging around for months, he says, and I finally agreed to go ahead and record it. And I listened to it. I kid you not. I mean, I think the first side I heard was "You Win Again." No. Crazy Arms. And I did not get 8 bars into it. I said, "Where in the hell is this cat?"
And it was just.
Sam Phillips signed the 21-year-old Lewis to Sun Records. Then, sometime in 1956, in a club called the Wagon Wheel, Lewis heard the song that would ignite his career.
I was walking in the club, I was late that night, and I heard this guy singing a whole lot of shaking going on. And I listened to it, and I said, man, I don't know where that's coming from. I said, that's Johnny singing it. I said, that is a hit. And he'd done the whole thing. I said, easy now, stand it in one spot and wiggle it around a little bit, you know. And that's where I learned a whole lot of shaking.
Jerry Lee did it, and we did the song, and we got such a tremendous response. I guess we must have had to play it at least a dozen times that night. So we all agreed on the way to Dallas, we talked about it, that the minute we got back to Memphis, we should go to the studio and record it.
We took just one take. That was it. We didn't even run through the song. We just sat down, and Jack Lemmy turned the machine on, and we cut a whole lot of shaking going on.
We got chicken and the barn. Who's the barn? What's the barn? My barn. Come on, honey. We got a fool by the horn. Oh, we ain't breaking. Whole lot of shaking going on. Easy now. Shake. Oh, shake, baby. You can shake one time for me. Oh, it's nothing nice to come on over, baby. A whole lot of shaking going on. Now let's get real low, shake. All you gotta do, honey, kind of stand in one spot. Jump around just a little bit. That's when you have flat got something, you know. Now let's go. Shake! Shake! Honey, shake! Shake, baby! Shake, baby! Shake! Big bacon!
I think it all stems from that intuitive thing about religion and about the fervor of the Holy Ghost in us all, in some way that we may not even know about.
By 1958, rock and roll by both white and black artists was dominating the airwaves everywhere. It had made record sales quadruple since 1956. But just when it seemed as if the battle was won, an incredible series of events nearly silenced both the musicians and the DJs who played them.
Payola was, we never called it payola. Payola was a word invented by the U.S. government. We called it promotion. And Chess Records was the only company that kept a full payroll book.
Many radio pioneers came under fire for accepting money for playing records, even though the practice was common and perfectly legal.
I was sent a check every month, and we were known as consultants. And bear in mind, this was not against the law at the time. I mean, there'd never been anything like this anyhow. So you could pick up it was much heavier in New York or Chicago or Detroit or L.A. than it was with us, even though we had this tremendous coverage. And as I said, it was not against the law, and we took it, and we weren't paid very much, so it was just part of the game.
Little Richard traded the devil's music for religion in January 1958. 2 months later, Elvis Presley entered the army. In May, Jerry Lee Lewis was blacklisted after marrying his 13-year-old cousin. Finally, Chuck Berry was imprisoned for transporting a teenage girl across state lines in 1959. But new talents came through to fill the gap.
I want to ask you a question. How old are all of you fellas?
Well, there's 218, 120, and I'm 21.
Even though their own career was tragically short, Buddy Holly and the Crickets set the standard for the coming decade and for bands like the Beatles. Original music played with two guitars, bass and drums. And new DJs emerged to play the music. The rock and roll genie had come out of the bottle and was ready for the decades of musical revolution to come.
It really is truly something that we at Sun Records, and I'm not pointing at me alone, but it's something that Sun Records did. And hey, Lord, all of these other great independent labels were doing it too. What we are proud of is we believe that we broadened the base of rhythm and blues, race music, spiritual music, gospel music, and if you please, rock and roll.
I think rock and roll actually came from us, the black people. We had the rhythm and blues for many, many years, and here come in a couple of white people, and they call it rock and roll, and it was rhythm and blues all the time. That's where it come from, us.
Meet me in a hurry behind the barn. Don't you be afraid that I'll do you no harm. I want you to bring along my rocking shoes, cause tonight I'm going to rock away all the blues. I heard the news, there's good to rockin' tonight. ¶¶